So we're going to be talking about Kubernetes runtime security, which I assume you've figured out because you found it on the program and found your way here so early. But before we get into that, let me tell you a little bit about myself, the person up here on stage. Hi, I'm Jen. I'm a security advocate at Google, and I work on Google's cloud platform. So in this role, what I do is I spend a portion of my time doing independent research, seeing what other people are up to, tinkering around myself, occasionally joining, you know, a red team or something like that. That's always fun. Trying to keep my skills fresh. And then the other part of the time I spend coming to conferences like this and spending time with customers and other people using cloud computing technology to share what I've learned. So it's kind of like a half teaching, half research kind of role. Except more focused on like a specific discipline, in this case, cloud computing and security. My background before that was as a developer advocate, which means my further background was in software development. So I was one of those developers causing all those problems, causing all those headaches for lots of people for many years with the complicated deployments with new technologies that were new and shiny and had some problems. And so I always love hearing from people. So if you ever have any questions for me about this, about anything related to cloud computing or Google Cloud Platform, feel free to drop me a line. The fastest way to reach me is with a DM on Twitter. I'm at MimminCodes on Twitter. I don't tweet much, but I do keep an eye on my DMs. So feel free to reach out to me that way. And if you'd like to reach out to me via a different communication technology, you can find those linked from the bottom of my homepage. That's also where I post all my conference slides and stuff like that. And that's on mimming.com. So enough about me. Let me ask all of you some questions about yourself. And this will help me kind of tailor the rest of our conversation this morning. So first, how many of you are familiar with the NIST cybersecurity framework? Almost everyone. Great. This is kind of a litmus test for security people, especially when I'm talking to software developer audiences. Thank you. Oh, I think I just created an N squared slide with animations. Anyway, how many of you run containers in production today? A bunch of you, cool. This is a growing and growing. Every time I ask this question, I see more hands, which is really exciting. Oh, I did create an N squared slide, but it's almost done. How many of you monitor those containers? Of those who raised your hands for question two, how many of you are monitoring those containers for events as they run? A few hands. Awesome. Hopefully I can increase that number maybe next week or after you've had some time to recover from the conference. Those of you who raised your hands for question number two. So here's our agenda for the rest of the talk. We're going to spend some time doing a container security overview to kind of set the foundation and kind of figure out the landscape so we can home in on the specific topic we're talking about. And then a little bit about those implications and how they're different from our old historical world of virtual machines to the new shiny world of containers. Then spend a big part of the talk talking about how to detect bad things that happen at runtime. And finally, I'll finish with a demo, in this case, a video of a demo, to illustrate what this looks like in action. Sound good? Okay, let's do it. First, the overview part, the beginning of our kind of information ramp. So Google has done a lot with containers, and you know Kubernetes is something we think is pretty cool, as you might think. But I hear a lot of really interesting things come out of other parts of the community. This is one quote that I love related to container security. Is that Kubernetes is so new that lots of practitioners don't know what security controls come with it. So one of the first things to do is study up on what controls are there and use them to strengthen your security posture. And most people think this comes down to like configuration and making sure that you're upgraded and all that stuff. And all this stuff is super important, but there are many other security features that can be relevant to other parts of your security posture. And it's really important to do this because we're already seeing security events with containers happening today. And this is probably a screenshot of a news article that you've seen on a bunch of container presentations during this week already. But essentially what happened is Tesla had a security event related to containers. And it was a really big bummer, although not as bad of a bummer as it could have been. So what happened was they left the wonderful Kubernetes dashboard running in a default insecure state on an older version of Kubernetes when that was the default. And it didn't have any password protection or anything, and nothing set up at all. It was completely open. Somebody found it, tinkered around, and investigated the machine it was running on, or rather the node, and discovered that that node had access to some credentials for their cloud provider. Oh, noes. And then they used those credentials to spin up a whole bunch of other resources and mine cryptocurrency, which is a bummer, because, like, you know, they ran up a bill. But I don't know, it could have been a lot worse. But it's still a lesson that all of us can learn from. Whenever we see these events happening, is what happened there, and what can we do differently to prevent that kind of thing from happening? Or, assuming that this kind of event's going to occur, what can we do to detect it quickly so we can respond? So, as I said, my organization's been running containers in production for a long time. And we've been thinking a lot about security on those containers and those containerized applications, too. And as part of kind of our general threat modeling exercise, we tend to take our threats and divide them up into groups so that we can focus on them specifically. You know, abstraction. We use that a lot in software. And three of the big groups that we use to gather up the different threats that happen to our containerized applications is infrastructure, software supply chain, and runtime. Infrastructure is all of the threats that could strike the underlying foundation technologies. So in a Kubernetes deployment, this would include things like a Kubernetes API compromise or privilege escalation up using Kubernetes components or a credential compromise within my cluster. But we want to deal with those separate from software supply chain issues. So one of the cool things that containerized development allows for us is to build these wonderful automated software supply chains, which means software developers can include a lot of dependencies. And a lot of stuff really easily can be added in, much, much more easily than in years past. And this means that we can also accidentally include vulnerabilities that were written by someone else. So unpatched vulnerabilities in some kind of dependency or library or something else that happened somewhere else down the software supply chain. So we partition these off in kind of a separate area, and we try and tackle them specifically as well. And then finally, runtime security. These are the events you can't really completely prevent ahead of time. Things like a distributed denial of service attack or a node compromise. So the underlying, the node itself becomes compromised. Or someone discovers a way to do a container escape. Or, you know, the unfortunate event of somebody dropping an OD on us, which can happen. And it's hard to prevent that with a secure supply chain. But you want to make sure that you have something in your overall posture to help deal with that. So the rest of this talk is going to focus on that third area, the area of runtime security, the area of things where we can't necessarily completely prevent it 100% of the time. So let's talk a little bit about the differences between like an older virtual machine deployment and a containerized deployment and how that might have implications around security. So first, let's look at them from the structural perspective. Here's a diagram. We've seen this diagram a million times throughout the years. And it's how things work in a virtualized environment. We have our underlying hardware and our underlying host operating system. And our host operating system is something we can probably log into. There's probably a shell in that. There might be a user interface. So it's a pretty fat host operating system. And it's a general purpose host operating system. And on that, we have a hypervisor that's running, which is kind of like an emulator. It's kind of like an interpreter for the virtual machines that run on top of it, which have their own guest operating system, which might be a full-featured operating system that we can log into with a shell and maybe a user interface. And then the stuff we actually care about, the binaries and libraries that we use for our application, all of our dependencies that live in there, and then our application code itself, stuff we've either purchased from a vendor and we're running in our virtual machine, or code we've written ourselves. It's a lot of different stuff out there just to run, you know, the small amount of code that we actually care about for the application. Containers, like the diagram looks only a little bit different, but there's actually some big structural differences. So we still have the same hardware. We're still running on the same physical media. We got to run on servers still, despite what the what people say about the cloud. It's other people's computers at the end of the day. There's physical hardware underneath. And we still have a host operating system, but generally for containerized runtime, not always, but generally you're going to be using a container-optimized host operating system, which means it can be much lighter weight, because all it really needs to do is be able to have containers deployed to it and run those containers. And the container runtime is partitioned off like the hypervisor here, but it's actually a lot different. Because containers aren't a whole virtual machine running in kind of an isolated interpreter. They're just a process that's provided by the host operating system. And the host operating system and its features are what actually enforces all that isolation. But we get some benefits for that too. We've actually peeled away a couple layers there. We no longer have a guest operating system, which means that deploying our binaries and libraries is much lighter weight than it was before. And one of the implications that doesn't show up here is we can end up partitioning our stuff off into much smaller pieces. It's much finer granularity, much more microservices and stuff like that. And we can end up deploying a whole lot more containers. Again, a much greater number because in implementation, they're much lighter weight, even though they appear very similar when you put them on a seven bubble diagram. But one of the biggest things that's difference between them can't be really easily expressed through a diagram like this. That's in how they end up playing out during runtime. Because whereas virtual machines, they were just cheaper hardware generally. Like some of us actually had set up systems where we were quickly deploying and tearing down virtual machines, but like it had expensive and it had lots of overhead. But in containers, that overhead is much lower, so we can actually really do the promise that virtualization had many, many years ago, which is we can make our deployment just kind of a state of a system, a state that changes over time. So as load increases, as load decreases, as new versions come out, as we add new features, we can roll things and we can create and destroy containers much faster and much more cheaply than before. And this is amazing from like the software developer perspective because it makes so many things that were so hard and so many kinds of deployments and infrastructures so much easier than it was before. Like having tried to do a startup with microservices like 12 years ago, it was really hard. It's so hard to the point where it really was not worth it. But now, like, it's a lot easier than it was before. But this, in terms of all the dynamic runtime behavior differences and the structural differences, are going to have some implications in how we think about security, obviously. So let's kind of go through those line by line. First, let's talk about attack surface. So containers generally have a minimalistic host operating system, a host operating system that is stripped down. And this reduces the attack surface, which is awesome. But on the flip side, containers are a little bit worse in a different regard. Hypervisors enforced a really strong security boundary. A lot of those system calls that were happening before got captured by the hypervisor and maybe turned into something else, maybe run completely in user space because of the way virtualization worked. Like a really old VM might be running everything in user space, although a lot of them get trickled down now for performance reasons. But yeah, a lot of those, the hypervisor isolation was much stronger than the container in that regard. When a container runs a system call, it's running that system call all the way down generally. How about resource isolation? As I mentioned, like DDoS and other denial of service type events are something we need to think about. So in a containerized world, like I said, it's just a process. So we use namespaces and C groups and other features of the host operating system to isolate our resources. And these, despite being just a process, these have much more expressive features, much more fine-grained configuration. So we can actually really restrict the resources of a container down to a certain amount of memory and a certain amount of CPU time, and it works pretty well. Whereas in our old virtual VM land, those boundaries are not as well separated. Or those resources are not as well isolated. Root permissions, you know, the keys to the kingdom. So in a containerized world, the access controls are our privileges, and shared resources are, I mean, their configuration, their access controls. So you're trusting that that feature of the host operating system is going to work, but we get pretty fine-grained controls over that stuff again. And it's configuration that we can deploy with our containers, and it's awesome. But containers have a wider access to a broader set of system calls. So if there's a problem with one of those system calls running that exposes a vulnerability, it's more likely that a load running inside a container is going to have access to it. So again, a little bit of a trade-off. And finally, in reference to kind of the dynamic nature of containers versus virtual machines, containers have a shorter average lifespan. And for somebody who does some red teamy stuff, this is the thing that makes the biggest difference of all. Because by the time you get to a container, so if you've compromised a container, by the time you've compromised it and started to investigate other, enumerate other resources you could potentially go off to build your web of influence in the organization, that container might be gone. Like, it might be up and down. Sometimes containers live for hours, sometimes for minutes. So by the time you've gotten in and your foothold's already gone. But on the flip side, from kind of a boot team and defensive standpoint, those containers go up and down. And if 2 weeks later I find out that somebody's been compromising containers for 10 minutes at a time, it's really hard to do forensics. I might have a log from my network side of some events with IP addresses on them that refer to physical hardware. And I might have no idea what containers are even running on that hardware at that time. So forensics can be a little bit more difficult. So the security implications kind of all together, there are pros and cons of each model of deployment. But none of them are hugely different. The approaches we need to take to dealing with this, the approaches we need to take to preventing problems are more the same than different. So we can use a lot of the same philosophies we've used before, just with a little bit of a different technological substrate in mind. So, now for the meat of it, let's talk about how to actually detect the bad things that happen at runtime. And the first question I usually get when I ask Pete, when I talk to people about this, is why bother? These secure software supply chain stuff is so good for containerized deployments. And I have vulnerability scanners. I don't need to bother with runtime security. I can prevent any problem. I want to prevent problems. I don't want anything to happen. But that's not something we can always achieve. Despite the fact that you have a secure software supply chain set up and no vendor vulnerabilities that are known end up on your system, and you might be too small of a target, at least that's what you think, for someone to drop an OD on you or something like that, this stuff can still happen. The vulnerability scan might have a bug in itself. There might be a misconfiguration and someone accidentally whitelists or blesses a container that's full of problems and pushes it out. Or someone accidentally deploys QA to production or something like that. These kinds of things do happen. So despite the fact that there are some really cool features of Kubernetes and containerized world to prevent problems from happening and to harden your systems, you need to admit that those things are not perfect and we need to use defense in depth. In other words, we need to avoid fence post security. If you put a giant fence post in the woods to block one kind of particular route of entry, you may see that fence post and be like, no one's going to be able to climb over this fence post. They'll walk up to the fence post and they'll just take one step to the side and walk around, despite how strong that fence post is. So this is definitely a case where defense in depth is going to be our friend. And this is where that first question comes in. Let's look back to the NIST cybersecurity framework for some, to kind of set our approach to how we're going to be dealing with the runtime side of it. This is something almost everyone here knows. But let's kind of rephrase it. Let's go through the same general points. Let's think about it from a containerized perspective. So first, identify and protect. We want to know what containers are running. This is something that's a lot easier. We actually have APIs to be able to do this. We can actually learn a lot more about our environment than we did before. We also want to use secure defaults to protect our containers. We want to use the configuration features. We want to upgrade it. When we upgrade our Kubernetes cluster, we want to pay attention to what security features changed in the upgrade and make sure that we apply those changes to our cluster too. Because especially if those are breaking changes, they might not automatically apply. But we also want to be able to detect container behavior that deviates from the norm. So we want to, if a container starts acting wonky, starts making calls that we're not used to, maybe stuff that we didn't think of ahead of time and prevent, we want to know that that happens. We want to be able to respond to a suspicious event inside of our container, and we want to be able to mitigate that threat. And then finally, we want to be able to recover. We want to be able to have an approach that allows us to do useful forensics and figure out what happened, why it happened, and make sure that we don't have containers suffer from the same problem again. Okay, so we've thought through this from a containerized standpoint, but the truth is, like, it's just the same as the regular phrasing for the NIST framework, just with a few words switched back and forth. Container has substituted many of the other terms. So we can use several of the same theoretical concepts we have in the past. So let's zoom in to detect and respond. So the solution, I'll reveal the solution in the end. You gotta have to have some kind of container-aware monitoring system in place. You have to have some kind of process or software that's monitoring your system and that is also aware of all the differences the containers have, both from a structural and from kind of a runtime perspective. So let's talk a little bit about the different design approaches that people have taken to building the software. So if you want to roll it on your own, you can have this in mind. Or you can just use this as information as you investigate the options that are out there in the ecosystem. So how are these going to work? The first thing they're going to have to do to be container aware is they're actually going to have to hook into your container. They're going to have some awareness and some kind of insight into stuff that's happening inside the container. The container is just a process from the outside, but they're going to have some features that allow them to understand the inside. And then they're going to log a bunch of stuff. And a bunch of stuff, I mean, different container-specific events. So things that are useful from that perspective. Then we're going to need some kind of policies for alerts. Of course, the first thing we'll want to do is we want to know when things are going wrong. But one of the really cool things that things like container orchestration, like Kubernetes, allow us to do is we have these wonderful APIs to make rapid changes to our deployments. And this doesn't just make deploying new software easier. It doesn't just make upgrades easier. It also means that we have the ability to do automatic remediation. We can have our own rule-based automatic remediation. And this is something that we definitely want to have available to us. And then, of course, we want to be able to do forensics afterwards. So what are the kinds of things that we're going to use? What are the technologies we're going to use to implement those goals? So I said we're going to be logging stuff. But the truth is, we're not just logging stuff. We want to be able to get insight into an enormous volume of events going on. Because network traffic on a host IP is not enough anymore. The container's going up and down and different things happening. We need a much higher granularity than we're probably used to from traditional monitoring designs. Which means that we're going to be looking at hooking into and investigating things like ptrace and kprobes and trace points. So incredibly high volume stuff that's close to like system call levels of volumes. If you're running newer version of the Linux kernel, the host operating system, you'll have access to things like eBPF, which is really cool. And XDP, which is Berkeley packet, enhanced Berkeley packet filters for network packets. And we also want to investigate potentially using user mode APIs for things like kernel activity, like iNotify. And depending on which ones you use, you're going to have different trade-offs in terms of what the performance overhead is and what level of insight you're able to get into events. Because things that have a lower performance overhead and only use a couple percent of your total resources, which is a lot, are going to give you less information. But if you find something with that promises an enormous amount of granularity, there's probably going to be a bigger performance price to pay. So knowing that we're using those things to hook in and those things to investigate and we're logging at that volume of events, I noticed a few patterns in all the different software that's out there that people have built to do this. And a lot of them shake out into the deployment models and the way they're storing the information. So, starting off, we have our container. We have a node with its kernel, the host operating system running on it. We have a container. That white container is our actual code, our thing that's running. It's running in a pod, because Kubernetes uses pods to group containers. This is a pretty simple deployment. It only has one container in the pod, and only one pod running on that system. But we want to monitor it just the same. So one thing that seems universal across all the different implementations I've seen out there, open source and commercial, is they have some kind of management container running on each node. And it's a container running in Kubernetes, so it's running on a pod as well. And this is where they start to diverge a little bit. Some of them use a kernel module. And because it's running down to the lowest levels, we get a lot of insight into what's going on. These solutions tend to be a little bit harder to use in managed container runtimes, which, from a general perspective, managed container runtimes make running Kubernetes secure a lot easier. Definitely investigate them if you're running Kubernetes in the cloud. They're awesome. But using a kernel extension is not always going to be possible in a managed container runtime, because you might not have access to the underlying nodes themselves to do that kind of stuff. So as an alternative, a lot of them will put a privileged container into each pod. And this is the benefit of working better with managed runtimes. And it'll run in situations where you can't do a kernel extension. And it gives you a lot of the similar levels of insight. And as events occur, it's going to report that back to the management container. And then we have the huge stream of events. And we can't just, like, the volume of events is so big, we can't just log them all out. There's just too many to do that with. So instead, we have to figure out a way to kind of sift through that as close to the source as possible. So a joke in software development is don't take the data to the code, take the code to the data. This is kind of like that, but backwards. We want to take the intelligence as close as possible to the big volume of data. So these are kind of the solutions most people have worked out. Generally, that meant the management container is going to be doing a lot of the filtering. It's going to be interpreting a lot of your rules. And then it's going to be sending them off to one of many locations. It might be writing them to a local database somewhere else in your cluster or next to your cluster. It might be writing them to a persistent disk that is attached to the machine. Or it could be sending off like a lower volume but higher signal events to a hosted database over to existing monitoring systems so that you can add other subsequent triggers to it. And one thing I've seen the few implementations do that's kind of clever is they run a ring buffer on the host node. And what's really cool about this is they can log very high resolution events to that ring buffer so that if something happens, if the management container detects an event, it can take the contents of that ring buffer that contain the last 10 seconds or last 30 seconds of data at really high volume, and it can dump that out to your cloud database or somewhere else secure. So that when you see an event, it can allow you to do much more detailed forensics on that. And these are really cool. It's kind of like a peek into the last 10 seconds of things that you wish you knew about when it happened. So those are a lot of different designs that the software developers have used to build monitoring systems. But the really cool stuff comes in our ability to automatically respond. This is using the strengths of Kubernetes to help us defend instead of just letting the complexity be a burden. So let's talk about that response. So the ways you might want to respond, the obvious first thing to do if you don't have monitoring in place now is just make sure you send alerts. This is always the first thing to do when you deploy some kind of remediation system. You want to know what's going on. You want to see the enormous volume of alerts that come out from the defaults of the software you've installed first. And then you want to figure out which of those events are not real signals, reconfigure things until your signal-to-noise ratio reaches a level that's more appropriate, until you're actually detecting events and not detecting normal behavior. And then you can start to take advantage of the other things you can do as part of a Kubernetes deployment, all this automatic remediation stuff. And this is where it starts to get really cool. Like, one thing you can do is if you detect an event that's bad, but not terrible, like maybe someone trying to mine cryptocurrency or something like that, like, it doesn't look like they're going out there to find, it's not obvious that they've figured out where they are. They just want to mine some quick Monero. They don't necessarily want to steal a bunch of your information. You might want to isolate that container. Take that container, change the network configurations of Kubernetes to isolate it, maybe connect it to a fake database if you're really sophisticated. And then what will happen is you're wasting the one resource that attacker has, you're wasting their time. So you have them isolated automatically. They might not know they're isolated, and that gives you an opportunity to get some really juicy forensics. When you finally reach your destination and get out of the car or whatever, you can go in there and you can see them actively doing stuff. They might be confused, but allow you to get some useful information. But sometimes you might have an event that's a little too scary for that. So you could have automatic remediation involving a bigger hammer, essentially. You could pause the container, so we can go in there, and you might have a reason to pause the container, and so you can save its state for later. Or if you think things have gotten worse than that and pausing it won't be sufficient, you could also restart the container or kill it. In this case, we're going to lose some of that information we could have for forensic analysis, but being able to automatically kill a process or restart a container, being able to kind of like roll your deployment, roll all the containers on a potentially compromised application is super useful. Because you can do this potentially without disrupting your application to your clients. And really disrupting, driving the attacker nuts. So, why are containers special again? Kind of sum up those differences between those. In the old days of virtual machine land, which is the current time for a lot of us, not trying to diss it or anything like that, we had long-lived systems. We had virtual machines, which were really just virtual hardware running, like as it says, virtual machine. They were virtual machines, and we treated them like that often because of things that don't show up in this diagram, because we had gigabyte images to move around and stuff like that. So we'd often deploy them, put them in place, create a network topology that didn't really change much, deploy our applications, and then we would leave those operating systems, those guest operating systems, running for years at a time sometimes, and we'd patch them just like real hardware. We'd deploy software to them, new versions, as we went. And in this case, that network topology was probably visible to intrusion detection systems that could only see like complexity at the level of our network. They could probably, you know, if there was an event that was associated with a piece of physical network hardware, we could probably figure out which virtual machine that was associated with. We could probably trace that back. But in the containerized land, we have super short-lived containers that probably only have one version of software on them ever. That software's probably deployed, the container's created, and then when we want to upgrade, we destroy that container. So for any intrusion detection system or any monitoring software, it needs to be aware of how containers work and container-specific potential problems. And a lot of this goes back to the fact that we have an overlay network that the most intrusion detection systems just aren't going to have much insight into. So before I get into demo-y stuff, what can you do today? What can you go ahead and do today? Everyone who's running containers or investigating running containers in the near future. First, make it part of your security plan. So if you're in a situation where you don't have any containers running in production yet, which is most of you, think about this before you start to deploy them into production. You know, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. This will put you in a good position because you get tons of time. You have tons of leeway to investigate all of the different open source options out there, because there are a few really awesome open source options out there for doing container monitoring. You might be able to integrate them into your existing system or use them in isolation. Even with the defaults, the open source options are a great option. Or you might have vendors that you work with already. This is an opportunity to talk to them and plan with them and figure out, do they have stuff that's container aware? Will it work? Will it detect the kind of events you're most concerned about? Or you can evaluate other commercial options. And the truth is, a lot of the shiny stuff is kind of dominated by vendors in this space. But the open source options are great if you don't need as much shiny interface. But having that time is super useful. The other thing I encourage you to do is deploy early. So even if you're already running containers, today is okay. It's better to do it before, to plan ahead of time, but planning now before there's an event is also good too. Get your baseline readings. Containers can be kind of chatty. They can look kind of suspicious when they're running. It can be hard to sift out the actual signal from the noise. So deploy stuff, see what signals come through, tune your readings, tune your signals, and make sure that you're getting useful information out. Because there's nothing worse than like discovering an event occurred by accident, deploying something to do investigation, and getting a fire hose of stuff you have to sift through on the spot to try and figure out what's going on. So if you have good baseline readings of a healthy system, you will know when things are unhealthy. And of course, rehearse an event. So this is where tuning those signals becomes really useful. So some of us have, like some organizations have the resources to do like regular red teaming. Some organizations don't. Some organizations, like maybe that one pen test a year that happens for like PCI compliance or something is all that happens. And normally we get the report and we throw it on our desk and we don't think much of it. But this is a great opportunity to use those existing things that we have to do or the things that we're doing anyway to tune those signals. Get an event. Rehearse an event that is unsuccessful. You know, if an event is unsuccessful, the penetration test is unsuccessful, now you can look at your signals. Should you have been able to detect anything that happened? Or if it is successful and you get really interesting, actionable feedback, what can you do to tune the different things you're monitoring for? What can you do to tune the automatic remediation? Could you have automatically remediated this problem before you even got, before you're able to respond to the notification? So take advantage of those rehearsals. It's a great dry run for the real thing, of course. So let's see this in action. Let's do a demo, or in this case, a video of a demo. So there it goes. So here I have a Kubernetes cluster running on GKE. I wonder if I can pause the video. Nope. We'll just go at full speed. So I have a Kubernetes cluster running on GKE, which is Google's Cloud Platform's managed container runtime. I'm running a very small Kubernetes cluster. It's WordPress. Because, you know, there's always WordPress out there. You never know when you're going to need to run WordPress or someone's going to run WordPress at your organization. But it's OK, because I've actually used one of the open source options for container monitoring. I'm running Sysdig's Falco, which is pretty cool. So here's my WordPress. It looks good. It's fully patched. It passed all of our vendor, you know, all of our software supply chain stuff. But the administrator didn't pick a very secure password for some reason, which could happen. And one of the funny things about WordPress, it's ubiquitous, but if an administrator's account gets compromised, you can put PHP code right into the editor interface, like this one little innocuous-looking line of PHP, which in this case, an attacker could compromise that administrator, drop in that one line, and no one would be the wiser, because you go to the 404 page, how often do you check your 404 page? Pretty much never. So the attacker could have their command and control system where they run fireup.netcat somewhere else on the internet, and then they can go tickle that 404 page. And when they tickle that 404 page, they get a shell on that WordPress system. Even though it's fully patched, this is WordPress operating as it's designed, it has a feature to write very expressive templates, which include the ability to express reverse shells. And then our attacker can go in, poke around, see what they can do while they're in the container, investigate other opportunities. They can try and mine some cryptocurrency, which I guess is one of the best outcomes of an event, like a container compromise. And in this case, they couldn't mine it. But it's OK, because I hacked up a little dashboard and about 20 lines of JavaScript, and we can see that that event was detected. And in this case, we can see that a debug shell was spawned by an untrusted binary. And this is using Falco's all the default settings. And it actually ended up with a pretty good signal-to-noise ratio on my deployment, in that when I tinkered around and I ran stuff and the regular monitoring happened, it didn't really end up with a very it wasn't very chatty, so I didn't see a lot of those problems there. Oh. But it did tell me that I had an untrusted binary spawn the shell, which is usually a sign of a really serious problem. That's one of the things in the default rule set. And I could tune that rule set to be more confined to the things I expect WordPress to do by default. And these events just came out. These would be really easy to integrate into any existing dashboard, anything like that. I just used a little JavaScript dashboard I hacked up and a couple hundred lines of code because, you know, vendor agnostic. So cool. So that's just a little peek into a really simple event on a really simple Kubernetes cluster and getting the details of the container that was compromised, what happened during the compromise, the host that reverse shell was going back to, and a lot of information that I might lose later when I'm investigating, you know, after that container goes away, after my WordPress cluster scales up and down to handle load, and it's gone. So that's the backup in case that I put my demo on YouTube too, just in case the slide doesn't play. So let's wrap it all up since we're running out of time. It sounds like we might have a couple minutes for questions. But this is what we discussed. So we discussed container security overall, how they differ from virtual machines, both structurally and in terms of their dynamic behaviors on the living system. Then I tried to convince you all not to build fence posts. As awesome as all the supply chain security features of Kubernetes are, which, if that does not sound familiar, go to some other session about Kubernetes supply chain security. It's awesome. I just wanted to talk about the other topic. But don't do just that. Also spend some time doing some monitoring. We wrapped up, and I was imploring you to do stuff early, earlier than later. So with that, thank you so much. My slides are available on the RSA like website if you go to the speaker page. They're also on my website if that's the place you'd like to grab them. So thanks a lot for coming. And I think we have a few minutes left for questions. Otherwise, there's some Google security talks across at the nearby shopping mall at the Westfield. I'm going to be hanging out there during the afternoon. So if you'd like to come chat with me about this or anything else related, swing by. I'll be out front hanging out in the demo area. So thanks so much. Hello, come on out. Yay, a question.
Yeah. Do you want me to just?
Either way. It may have you, whatever you're comfortable with.
Okay, so I noticed like in one of your slides, like you had a slide that you had a container and it had a it is a privileged container. And then maybe to connect to the management controller. Mm-hmm. But when you enable a container with privileges, isn't that a little bit more dangerous as well? Because basically you're giving it the same, it's like whatever, if you give it a privilege, it can do whatever basically the host OS can do as well, right?
Yeah, that's a great question. The question was about running, I told you to run stuff as root or close to root, virtual root, so that you can detect when things happen. And this is kind of the paradox on security monitoring in general, is that to get insight into deep layer stuff, right, whatever's doing the looking has to be privileged. And this is a trade-off that we have to make. So you are trusting that the security system, that your warden is safe enough that it's not gonna go and cause a bunch of its own problems. Because yeah, so if you're using something, if you have an unpatched old version of monitoring, that's gonna be one of the biggest threats to your system. So you should definitely make sure you take all of your normal practices and knock them up a notch. And make doubly sure that it's patched and stays current. That you keep an eye out for vulnerabilities on that, especially if you're managing yourself and using an open source version. And then, yeah, you need to solve that set of constraints for yourself. It is an increased risk in one way, but it's also the only way to detect when things go wrong. So unless you have some other detection in place that doesn't require that, then that's great. Thank you, Bert. That's a great question. Yeah, another live question.
What are some of the tools, like I don't want to endorse anything, but I just wanted a list of tools.
So a list of tools. So the one I already revealed is I use sysdigsfalco, which is the open source option. But other than that, I will show you a list after. I have a list on here. I'd rather than try and repeat them from memory. I have a list of, specifically, the list I have in mind is the vendors I've worked with a lot that have integrations into our managed runtime. But I'd be happy to show you that in a couple minutes. Any other questions? Where is the Google event? Oh, yeah, so there is a Google event. There is a Westfield shopping mall on Market near 4th. And then at the top of the room, top of the mall, there is a bespoke, like head towards the movie theater. And then we have a large space, event space set up. And there's a bunch of like Google Talks going on and stuff like that. And I'll be hanging out in the entryway. There's a bunch of kind of like security demo station things. And I'll be hanging out there, handing out security keys probably, because I'm, yeah, Westfield, the Westfield Mall, the Bespoke. So if you map search for Bespoke, it'll come up. Oh, I'm a big fan of strong authentication. So those universal two-factor keys. I'll have my stash. I'll be passing out, but I don't have them with me at the moment. Yeah, that's unrelated to this topic though. I just think strong authentication is like super useful. Any other questions while I'm up here? Otherwise, happy to chat without the mic on. All right, thanks so much, everyone.